September 7, 1940. After months of stalemate conflict between the British Royal Air Forces and the German Luftwaffe, Hitler set his priorities to the heart of the British country, London. Hitler's strategic plan was to bomb the city and destroy it physically, mentally, and spiritually, essentially pledging the deaths of British civilians. The Blitz had officially begun. As the sun set in London, the Luftwaffe plunged the city into a cauldron of fire and devastation. Reports from civilians that day read, "It was a night when London was ringed and stabbed with fire. They came just after dark, and somehow you could sense from the quick, bitter firing of the guns that there was to be no monkey business this night." Shortly after the sirens wailed, you could hear the Germans grinding overhead. In my room with its black curtains drawn across the windows, you could feel the shake from the guns. You could hear the boom, crump, crump, crump of heavy bombs at the work of tearing buildings apart. They were not too far away. Unfortunately, when the night ended, 300 German bombers had raided London. 1,413 civilians had died, 3,000 had been injured, and 9,000 bombs had been dropped. September 7, 1940 was the first of 57 consecutive nights of chaos and misery. A vulnerable country at the time, Britain was the only standing power battling Nazi Germany. Norway, Belgium, Holland, France, the list of countries that have all collapsed with the German Blitzkrieg goes on. Winston Churchill, new Prime Minister of Britain, was the lonely leader going against the massive army of Hitler. Churchill faced an uphill battle with the burden of his country's civilians on his back. The bombings continued the night after September 7th. They became a common occurrence to the people of London. The noise of the siren became familiar. The procedure of taking shelter had been memorized. The sound of the German bombers became the symphony of war that played in the heads of the demoralized civilians. Numerous lives were lost as the days went on, yet behind every statistic, there was a story. The people of London have experienced the horror that one would experience in 10 lifetimes. Yet despite all this, Hitler's strategic plan to break the city and the country was not working. In his own words, and as the leader of the country, Churchill proudly claimed that the city and the people would never surrender. Churchill surprisingly was not a fan of the radio, but overlooked his hate for it and instead used it as a tool to communicate with the people. This weapon of communication was more powerful than any amount of bombs that Germany dropped. Taking advantage of this, Churchill used his device to communicate with his people and to connect with them. Just days after the first bomb had dropped on the city, Churchill delivered his speech to the London civilians.
"These cruel, wanton, indiscriminate bombings of London are, of course, a part of Hitler's invasion plan. Little does he know the spirit of the British nation or the tough fiber of the Londoner. This wicked man, the repository and embodiment of many forms of soul-destroying hatred, this monstrous product of former wrongs and shame, has now resolved to try to break our famous island race by a process of indiscriminate slaughter and destruction. What he has done is to kindle a fire in British hearts, here and all over the world, which will glow long after all traces of the conflagrations he has caused in London have been removed. He has lighted a fire which will burn with a steady and consuming flame until the last vestiges of Nazi tyranny have been burnt out of Europe, and until the old world and the new can join hands to rebuild the temples of man's freedom and man's honor upon foundations which will not soon or easily be overthrown.
On the contrary, if tonight the people of London were asked to cast their vote as to whether a convention should be entered into to stop the bombing of all cities, an overwhelming majority would cry, no, we will mete out to the Germans the measure and more than the measure they have meted out to us. The people of London with one voice would say to Hitler, you have committed every crime under the sun. Where you have been the least resisted, there you have been the most brutal. We do not expect a hit without being hit back. And we intend with every week that passes to hit harder. Prepare yourself then. Prepare yourselves, my friends and comrades. In the Battle of London, for the renewal of your exertions, we shall not turn from our purpose, however somber the road, however grievous the cost, because we know that out of this time of trial and tribulation will be born a new freedom and glory for all mankind. We will have no truce or parley with you or the grisly gang who work your wicked will. You do your worst, and we will do our best.
His words touched the hearts of the London people and revitalized the inspiration within the small nation to face their biggest threat. Much like the bombs, the words of Churchill echoed in the ears of the people. Churchill's broadcasts throughout the London bombings helped motivate many to continue on and endeavor the next day. He motivated them to face their enemy with their best and to die standing rather than accept defeat kneeling. The efforts of Churchill to keep his people's morale up resulted in German defeat in Britain, as Hitler was unable to break London. The famous saying, "London can take it," is proof that Churchill allowed Britain to advance as a nation. His endeavors to keep fighting earned him the nickname the British Bulldog, as he paved the way for the next step in defeating Germany. Despite only giving 33 speeches throughout World War II, his words impacted the lives of millions. His words reached all over the globe during 1940 and even still today. Churchill's words lived on as one of the most important weapons used to defeat Hitler and the Nazis.
This heart and mind embraces.